First off, thank you all for coming. This event is being organized along with the Center for Remembering and Sharing, also being put together by the New York Sierra Club, Abolition 2000, and organization I'm a member of called Shutdown Indian Point Now. If you want to get involved in anti-nuclear grassroots activism, targeting the Indian Point nuclear power plant and fighting for the abolition of nuclear weapons and nuclear power, right here in New York City and also in solidarity with Japan, sign up to the group's mailing list. We have flyers set up outside. Chris's book is available here, Solutions to the Capitalist Ecological Crisis, Ecology and Socialism. And you can also read his latest writings at counterpunch.com and also in the latest edition of Z Magazine. So check that out. There'll be times, Chris is going to speak for about 40 minutes, and then there'll be an opportunity for questions and remarks that are, they're all very welcome. And the last thing I'd like to say, or I should say, is that there'll be room for announcements at the end, so we can all sort of plug into what sort of great activism folks around the city are doing. I know there's a lot of events coming up around the anniversary of the Fukushima disaster. So without further ado, I'm going to hand the floor over to Chris Williams.
So I thought I would just start off by putting some context to the situation with nuclear power. And it's not really possible to talk about nuclear power without also talking about nuclear weapons. And so I think the two are very connected for reasons that I could go into. But people may have heard about the announcement by the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists. This was an organization that was founded in the aftermath of the attacks on Japan and the development of nuclear weapons post Hiroshima and Nagasaki, in an attempt to say that we need to rid the world of nuclear weapons. They were so horrified by what science and scientists had created that they felt that something needed to be said and done. And at the same time, they created what has been labeled the doomsday clock, which has gone backwards and forwards with how many minutes we are to midnight, and essentially annihilation as a species. And just recently, they announced that the clock has now moved closer to midnight, 5 minutes to midnight. It's not the closest it's been but it is particularly scary. And the reason that they made that announcement was for a couple of reasons. One was because there are still 19,500 nuclear weapons in the world. The overwhelming majority, 95% of them, owned by the United States and Russia. It could destroy the world several times over. The efforts to reduce them seem to have stalled. In fact, in many respects, quite the opposite is going on. There is an expanding group of nuclear powers. We're now at 9, with a whole host of other countries wanting into the nuclear club. And for all kinds of reasons, and of course, now we're hearing the drumbeat of war once again in the Middle East with the potential attack by Israel and or the United States on Iran for their supposed nuclear weapons program. And you have to ask if countries want a civil nuclear power program. And they always say that there's a separation between the civil nuclear program and the military. But there are many ways in which dual use things can be had. And obviously, if it wasn't possible, then countries wouldn't be so engaged in trying to prevent Iran, which actually has the legal right to develop civil nuclear power, from having nuclear reactors. In any case, that is obviously something that is on the horizon. And to quote from the report on nuclear power out of a report by Robert Oppenheimer that was issued by the US State Department, a report on the International Control of Atomic Energy, which was written in 1946, states that the development of atomic energy for peaceful purposes and the development of atomic energy for bombs are in much of their course interchangeable and interdependent. And in other words, you don't get one without the other. And that would be one of my reasons, there are many, but that would certainly be one of my reasons for rejecting nuclear power as an option. The other one would be to do with climate change, which has swayed some environmentalists to say, well, if we're really going to get rid of fossil fuels, then we actually need nuclear power. And I'm part of the campaign to shut down Indian Point, which is about 30 miles away from where we are sitting right now. Very scary proposition that they want to relicense that old and leaking plant for another 20 years. According to the International Atomic Energy Agency, whose mission is to promote nuclear power, a quote from a report of theirs, nuclear power is not a near-term solution to the challenge of climate change. The need to immediately and dramatically reduce carbon emissions calls for approaches that can be implemented more quickly than building nuclear reactors. It also calls for actions that span all energy applications, not just electricity. Improved efficiency in residential and commercial buildings, industry and transport is the first choice among all options in virtually all analyses of the problem. And interestingly enough, in Japan right now, there are 54 nuclear reactors, but only 3 of them are in operation. And so then the question arises, but there are no power cuts. So how is it possible for a country that supposedly needed nuclear power for 30% of its energy to be running perfectly fine without hardly any nuclear power plants operating? And the answer, of course, is that conservation efforts by the people of Japan and massive oversupply, because whenever you build a nuclear power plant, it is enormous, and 1 gigawatt each. And so you have to build in. You're basically encouraging consumption by building such huge plants, because then you have to justify them staying on all the time, because the only way nuclear plants can even vaguely come close to making economic sense is if you operate them 100% of the time. And so I think that is now that the big campaign in Japan at the moment is to make sure that they don't reopen. So the governors in the different prefectures have the right to say, we don't want it reopened under pressure of the people. So they're trying to restart 2 at the moment, but if they don't, then by April, all nuclear power plants in Japan will be offline. The crunch is going to come, as I was told by some of the Japanese activists that I met over there, that the crunch will really come in July and August, when there is a much greater demand for electricity and whether people can cope. But at the moment, people have reduced their electrical demand by 25%, and so they don't need them. And so a lot of Japanese are like, well, why did we ever build them in the first place? Whose idea was it? And as many people I spoke to in Japan have told me, the independence of Japan since the Second World War is a mirage, and really they are following the foreign policy interests of the United States government, whereby Japan is under the nuclear umbrella of the United States, whereby the United States government pretty much openly said, what we want is a Japan that will be the Great Britain of the East. In other words, ours to basically run and control in the interests of US geostrategic imperial politics, particularly now with reference to the rise of China. And I think it's very difficult to explain why the only country that has suffered a double nuclear attack and is still suffering from that attack would build all these nuclear reactors. And when you look at where the reactors are, every single one of those 54 reactors is built on the coastline. None of them are inland or anywhere like that. So another, and you know, it is the land of volcanoes. It's geologically active. Obviously suffers from earthquakes all the time. Why would you build nuclear reactors there? And what's exciting, of course, as other people told me in Japan, if there's one positive thing to come out of the horrendous catastrophe, ongoing catastrophe, that will be ongoing for decades now, of Fukushima, will be the end of nuclear power in Japan, and as an inspiration to the rest of the world to say, you don't need it. People there really wanted to pass on the message that they wanted to be at the forefront of the anti-nuclear movement as inspiration for everybody else. How bad could it have been, or how bad is it? Well, this is from the Times the other day. They didn't know for at least a...
Please turn yourself on.
She's fine.
They didn't know how bad it could have got. And so there is a document, 15-page document, that is at the moment an internal document, but has been admitted to its existence by the Japanese government, that they actually were considering, in a worst case scenario, having to evacuate not just the 110,000 people that are still currently evacuated, cannot go home, partly because of the radiation, but also because of the tsunami. People don't have homes to go to. But they were contemplating, according to this report, the possible evacuation of the whole of Tokyo, 35 million people, and other major cities within a 110-mile radius of Fukushima Daiichi, if they completely exploded, lost control, all of which were possibilities. Thankfully, that didn't happen. But the fact that they have no idea what's going on in the midst of this crisis is obviously extremely worrying. And to read just a few snippets, there's been an interim report which has been translated into English. The Investigation Committee on the Accidents at Fukushima Nuclear Power Station that the government sanctioned, and some of it was reported in the Times, but it's shocking how dysfunctional the situation was at the time, from the country that seems to be, on the surface at least, most capable and most organized in terms of making plans for disasters. You can imagine, having seen and lived through the nightmare that was Hurricane Katrina and the dysfunction of the US government in coping with that, imagine what would happen if we suffered anything on the scale of this kind of disaster. And of course, Indian Point is only 25 miles from here. So they had an off-site emergency center that was located 5 miles from Fukushima Daiichi. But the report mentions the off-site center had to be evacuated because of the following reasons: difficulty in assembling staff members due to damaged transportation and heavily congested traffic caused by the earthquake, loss of telecommunication infrastructures, power cuts, shortage of food, water, and fuel, and elevated radiation levels in the building, which was not equipped with air cleaning filters. In other words, their emergency center was abandoned because it was totally unplanned for this level of accident. the crisis management, they took two crisis management centers, one on the fifth floor of the Prime Minister's office and one in the basement. And according to the report, they couldn't communicate with each other in Tokyo. As it says, the emergency gathering team members on the underground floor could hardly get hold of the discussions taking place on the fifth floor. When the integrated responses by the entire government setup are of critical importance, there was insufficient communication between the fifth floor, the emergency HQ, and the emergency gathering team. And so this is really a truly scary kind of prospect that they couldn't actually communicate five or six floors between each other. The report goes on, actually, they weren't communicating with TEPCO either. And the Ministry for Trade and Industry, METI, is just down the road from TEPCO headquarters. It's about a 10-minute walk, but they weren't communicating either. And the first people to leave Fukushima Daiichi were the TEPCO officials. They got out first. And so they obviously knew that something very bad could have gone on. The report goes on, I'm not going to quote it anymore, but goes on to say that it seems clear that some parts of the operation of the nuclear plant were not understood properly by TEPCO officials or the regulators. And now we are hearing reports that they always denied that there were cracks to the containment vessels as a result of the earthquake and tsunami. That happened really after the earthquake, but now it seems the earthquake itself caused some of the cracks, which means that the containment structure was already damaged well before the tsunami and the loss of power. So it's not just about a loss of power and who could have predicted a tsunami after an earthquake. I don't know, it's happened lots of times before in Japan. So that means that their ideas and about what the earthquake could do to a nuclear containment vessel were not adequate. There are many more criticisms, too numerous to mention, one of which the speedy computer system, which was meant as an early warning system for where is, in the event of an explosion, where is the radioactive plume going, so that we can let people know that they need to stay in their houses or they need to evacuate beyond the 20-kilometer evacuation zone. Well, that nobody could interpret the data in the exact express purpose of when you need to interpret the data. They didn't release it to the Japanese public, and so people in the line of the radioactive plume as it came over from the explosions were all receiving higher radiation doses than they would otherwise. Who did the Japanese government give the speedy data 2 days after the explosions? The U.S. military. The U.S. military, according to the Japan Times, received the speedy data, but the Japanese people did not. And this is also leading to a huge scandal in Japan. So I think that kind of lays out where we are now. And people may well have heard the recent news that they just approved two new reactors to be built in Georgia, the first two new nuclear reactors to be built in this country since 1978. They're not even waiting for what can we find out from what really happened at Fukushima? What extra enhancements should we make? They're not even waiting for the full report on the disaster before they're already starting to build new ones in this country. You would have to say that represents a gross dereliction and negligence to protect the people of this country from further disasters. Why wouldn't you wait in order to find out what really happened, and are your systems really adequate? And we already know that certainly the Japanese systems, some of which were actually voluntary, by the way, and all the ones that were voluntary, like protection from tsunami and so on, TEPCO, the nuclear corporation that runs those plants, did not take. Why? Because that would have cost more money. So they did a risk cost-benefit analysis and said, forget about it, we're not doing it. And that is obviously the danger of not having real regulation in place. Obviously a conversation that is going on in many different areas in the United States at the moment. So the other thing that, of course, that is they produce, just like they do here, glossy education brochures for the very primary level, middle school, and high school about the supposed benefits and safety of nuclear power in Japan, that if people want to check out, if you speak Japanese, then you can look at those. but people really wanted to give you those. So if you could. So part of the reason that I went over to Japan, there's really kind of a couple of reasons that I went over to Japan. This is actually here from a meeting that we helped to put on when there was a delegation from Japan and Fukushima. Some people in the room were at that meeting. And I was invited to go back. And I had a couple of reasons for wanting to do that. One was to get first-hand information and try and bring that back and write articles and so on, get that some of that published. To let people know that this was an ongoing nightmare that had not ended when the government said everything was fine. And the second reason was to build the anti-nuclear movement in the United States. There hasn't been a really vigorous anti-nuclear movement in this country for some time now, and I would really like to change that. So that was the other reason. I think that a belief that we need to close down the nuclear plants as an environmentalist has to be part of any campaign for environmental sanity, ecological, and social justice. So I would really like to see a new anti-nuclear movement reborn so that young people can take over and run it. This was one of these are some of the people I met here and back in Japan too. Satsuko Kaori, I think you could keep going. Thanks. No visit, I think, to Japan. This is my first visit to Japan. No visit. They have trains in Japan. Amazing. And they run on time, and they're immaculate, and they're spectacularly efficient, clean, etc., etc. Shinkansen run at 300 kilometers an hour. They could get to, you know, anywhere in the country, even including Fukushima Daiichi, the prefecture around there. All of those trains are still running. And so I just thought that I would pay homage to a country that takes seriously public transportation. I was going to show some pictures of the toilets, which was really impressive. I wanted one of those at home, but I cut those out. Not that I didn't take several. The other thing, a couple of other things that pointed to the nature of my trip. This is not really about me, but I learned two additional words of Japanese, and all the people there were phenomenal. But the two words give you a flavor for what it was like to be there at the time. One was oishi, which means delicious, and all the food was totally delicious. The other one was genpatsu, which means nuclear power. And so that was what was on everybody's mind and everybody's lips. And so that was constantly repeated in all the meetings. So I learned those two words. And I guess one other thing. This is not the airport. This is the subway in Tokyo. Quite spectacular when you think about what we have to deal with. And it doesn't really look quite the same, does it? When you go down into Union Square. So this is the kind of thing that, you know, this is supposedly the richest country in the world. Why aren't we investing in things like this? There are millions of people without jobs. Why can't we have public infrastructure like this? And then the other, there's lots of amazing things about Japan. One is, these are government ministers, bureaucrats up here, and this is a meeting of activists in Tokyo. And they're all presenting data and information to the government bureaucrats about what they need to be doing, the information they need to release, the radiation monitoring they need to be doing, the situation with the nuclear power plant. There's a couple of hundred activists here. And the government bureaucrats have to sit and listen and take in all this information. Not the kind of access that we're accustomed to over here either. The other amazing thing about being in Japan was I kept going to all these meetings, and there's always space being provided, and they were really nice locations, and just like this space, but they were provided for any citizen, free of charge. Seems like another right that would be a good thing here. Go ahead. So this is one of the many meetings that I went to. This is outside the Ministry of Trade and Industry, and is an occupation that when I was there had been going on 109 days. They want to continue it for 10 months and 10 days, which traditionally is the incubation period of a fetus in Japan, for reasons that I didn't totally understand. But anyway, the point was that there was a women's tent, there was a men's tent, and this is where all the demonstrations were congregating. So there were it varied in occupation size, but they built tents, they occupied the area out there, and were protesting. People were basically protesting a couple of different things. One was that they needed better information from the government on what the real situation was with the radiation. And people have been basically forced to get turned into amateur radiologists. So everybody around the Fukushima prefecture has to carry, basically, or chooses to carry, Geiger counters and knows all of the different units that radiation comes measured in and what is a dangerous level and so on and so forth. And you can just imagine what that does to your stress levels and your ability to function as a human being with your families and all this kind of stuff when you don't really know. And so they really want the government to do something more with that. And they also want to evacuate more people, in particular young people and pregnant mothers, because we know that radiation affects different age groups differently. Obviously, if you're growing, your cells are multiplying much faster, and so you cannot tolerate the level of radiation that an adult could. The third thing is better support for the people who are voluntarily evacuating. So there are some forced evacuations, and then there are a lot of people who are voluntarily evacuating, and I'll talk a little bit about those. So this is a woman I met at the occupation. She's one of the leaders. She's part of the coalition for the Fukushima organization for saving children from radiation, Chieko Shina. I'm going to commit all kinds of horrendous pronouncement problems. I apologize for that. She's an organic farmer from Miyagi Prefecture, which is just to the north of Fukushima Prefecture, but she can't any longer be an organic farmer, and so she is now basically living in this encampment full time because she believes that this is a struggle that needs to be won. As she said to me, radiation and life cannot go together. It's human nature to fight, and this fight is international. The action to change the system makes you change. Both are important and necessary. This unequal power structure will lead to change, and so the slogan that she is using at this demonstration is "Women are pregnant with the future," which is echoed in the March 11th demonstration that is being organized at Union Square, where women are pregnant with the fear of radiation, in solidarity with the demonstrations that are coming in Japan.
What was her feeling about the land? She's an organic farmer. I'll
talk a little bit about that, because I want to talk a little bit about that. That's a good question. If people do have questions, they can just throw them out, and I'll try and answer them. I'll finish in maybe 30 minutes, and then we'll have lots of time. Unfortunately, what the Japanese government has actually done is the internationally agreed upon maximum that any civilian should be exposed to in a year is 1 millisievert of radiation. So rather than have to evacuate many, many more people, they just changed the level at which was seen as appropriate. So now this is a protest poster with the new level. So they increased the safe level of radiation 20 times to 20 millisieverts per year. And obviously this is something that people are very, very angry about. And it's a child eating radioactive food, specifically because, as I said, not only is there a difference between young and old and pregnant mothers, fetuses, and adults in terms of your radiation dose, but there is a huge difference between internal radiation and external radiation. So if you ingest radioactive food, water, or anything else, or just breathe it in, radioactive particles, then that is much more dangerous than having it on your skin. At least your skin provides some kind of a barrier. But once it's inside your body, it can stay there for the rest of your life, potentially, continuously emitting radiation. So people were buying iodine tablets, or lots of people were buying iodine tablets in this country too. After about 3 months, you don't really have to worry about radioactive iodine because it's got a half-life of 8 days, and basically the radiation, any radiation is going to be safe after about 10 half-lives. So 3 months later and no radioactive iodine, basically. Why would you want to do that? Because the radioactive iodine goes to your thyroid, which controls growth and so on. And if you flood your body with iodine, you won't take up the radioactive stuff. The worst problem are things like strontium and cesium, which have half-lives of 30 years and remain radioactive, therefore, and dangerous for 300 years, 10 half-lives. So what we're talking about is radioactive strontium and cesium. Strontium, which would be taken up by your bones, and cesium, which would be taken up by your muscles, preferentially, then incorporated into your body, obviously, is far more worrying. So we're already talking about 300 years into the future, and in fact, they found plutonium up to a couple of hundred miles away, traces of plutonium, and plutonium is not an, doesn't exist on the planet. It's only manufactured inside nuclear reactors. And so the only way it could have got 200 miles away is from inside the nuclear reactors, which means that the nuclear reactors themselves, the core, was breached. Not just the outer containment system, but the inner core. And they just admitted today, the Japanese government, they actually have no idea what's going on inside the core. They can't, because they've never looked inside. It's too radioactive. So how much fuel is melted down in the three melted down reactors, and where it is, and how much has gone through the bottom, nobody can really say, but we do know that some has gone spread far and wide. So this is not the kind of levels of radiation that are going to immediately kill you or be noticeable or prevalent in the short term, but certainly over the longer term, if you're constantly there eating the food and they found contaminated rice and various other things, then that's a real problem. And Fukushima Daiichi, Fukushima Prefecture, one of the other problems is they called the nuclear power plant Fukushima Daiichi because it's in between two towns, really. But that means that it's really affecting the whole of Fukushima Prefecture, which is a much larger area. That and because food is labeled in Japan by the region that it comes from, nobody will buy any food from anything that, that says Fukushima on it because it's associated now with a nuclear power plant, even if it's from safe areas of Fukushima. So this has totally devastated the local economy of farmers and so on who could maybe sell their produce, but only at drastically reduced prices. So it's a nightmare even for the people who are trying to live and maintain their own ability to live. Thank you. So this was somebody that Hiroyuki Yoshino. This is a conference that I went to in Kuriyama City, which is in Fukushima Prefecture, just outside of Fukushima City itself. And the slogan above the speaker says, "We never give up about the judge's decision," because there was a judge basically had just said that 100 millisieverts total exposure over a lifetime was totally fine. What are people worried about? And so there's a lawsuit now against the judge, and people are campaigning. And so Hiroyuki has already evacuated his four-year-old child, and his wife to Kyoto because of concerns about the radiation levels for them. But so he only sees them once a month now. So this is the new reality for people. But he has stayed there, because he's working to force the government, or hopefully try and force the government, to take the radiation exposure, particularly of young children, more seriously and start evacuating, even if it's just for a month during when they're off school or whatever, just to kind of get them out of the radiation zone for a short period of time at least. This is his child, who I met in Kyoto. So there are a lot of people involved in the anti-nuclear movement in Japan, which is really, really encouraging. Many, many long-time environmental activists. This is a well-known photographer, Mr. Ryuichi Hirokama. He's the chief editor of Days Japan, a very well-known magazine photojournal in Japan, extremely well-known photographer. He actually went to photograph and do photo essays from Chernobyl, which was certainly part of my youth, and one of the things that really affected my thinking on nuclear power. And so this is another meeting that I went to where he was demonstrating that, he'd also now sneaked into the exclusion zone and taken photos of the damaged plants there. And so this was a presentation, another presentation of activists, where he was talking about the connection between what still exists at Chernobyl. 2003, they just had to evacuate three more towns in Belarus because the radiation levels were too high. In Germany, you cannot eat the wild boar because they feed on the mushrooms in the forests in northeastern Germany, and that's too radioactive. So that was 25 years ago last year, actually. And so there's still a 30-kilometer exclusion zone around Chernobyl. I'm not saying that they're the same exact disaster, but you can see the long-term effects of nuclear power. Some of the other people, I went to Soma, which is about 25 or so kilometers away from the plant, and this is Hatsumi Terashima and his wife Yuko, and a neighbor. They, behind them is where their village used to be, or town. And they took me to where their house was before the tsunami. He's been a fisherman for 54 years, him and his family. He doesn't have a boat anymore. He doesn't have a house. They collectively lost five members of their family in the wave that came over the tsunami. 264 people died from this village. They lost five family members. Son, their wife, a child, two grandparents, and what does he spend his time doing now? Well, basically, he's dredging he's not fishing anymore, but he is out on a boat, paid for by the government to dredge the waste and the detritus from everything that's gone out into the oceans. So this is now where they're living. This is the new accommodation provided for by the government. So there are thousands of these dotted all over the countryside. Like I said, there's 110,000 people. I'm sorry. Is everybody comfy? There's some little space down here. People need to move around a little bit. You're all right over there? Yeah. Sorry. I mean, it's a good problem to have that so many people are interested in this story. So, but I do apologize if you aren't totally comfortable. But there is some space down here anyway. This is government run and operated small communities for people who have been displaced. People are actually now starting to change, and they're no longer using the word evacuee because that implies that you go back. So they've actually people are starting to use the word diaspora. They're part of the Fukushima diaspora. In other words, they don't think they're ever going to be able to go back. And for some people, that will absolutely be true, unfortunately. There's about 3% of the land in Japan is now radioactively contaminated, to give you a sense of how far it's spread. So I took a few photos of this because this is, or was, their town. You could obviously see the devastation. Hatsuma, the fisherman who I was speaking to, was actually in his house at the time, and there was a saying in that area that they didn't think, because of the shape of the land and so on, that a tsunami would ever strike. So when he saw this huge wall of water moving towards him, he couldn't really believe it, but he was dragged 3 kilometers inland. His leg was broken. He just managed to grab onto a rope and eventually was hauled to safety. That's why he survived. But this is kind of all the remains of the area in Japan that they're from, which is also outside of the exclusion zone, the radiation exclusion zone. This is him explaining the whole situation. but within the ocean around there is contaminated and he can't fish. He was showing me what's all that's left, really, of the, keep going, thanks. This is Itate, which is outside, another area that's outside of the exclusion zone, beyond the 20 kilometers, but was in the path of the radioactive plume. So you cannot live there anymore. It's too radioactive. So the whole town, it was a very eerie experience because you drive into the town and there's nobody there. The street lights are on. The only other lights that are on are actually in the old people's home because they're too old and frail to move. And when they tried to move people, they were dying. And so the workers who work in that old people's home do so on strict shifts, coming and going. But this is outside the town hall. And this is reading in microsieverts, the radiation level 1.13 or something, microsieverts per hour. This is now the reality for people there. Obviously, what are those people doing? Everybody, as I said, carries guy. I took my own Geiger counter, but I absolutely didn't need it because so many other people had that. That was 1.13 microsieverts, but as soon as you hold the Geiger counters near the ground, then the radiation level goes up. So this is 4, 4.5 or so, and in other places. One of the problems is that the radiation moves around, right? There's wind, there's rain. One day it'll be, yes?
Is that a question? Yeah. I noticed water was used to cool the nuclear reactors. I presume it was disposed on the sea. What concerns arise from that?
Yeah. It's actually illegal to dump at sea radioactive waste under international treaty. But they got around that by saying, we're not dumping at sea because it's coming from the land, so into the sea. So they were accumulating so much radioactively contaminated water because there was no water for pumping, so where were they going to get the water from? They got it from the ocean. So they had hundreds of thousands of tons of radioactively contaminated water. And TEPCO have just said that what they're doing is they've decontaminated 220,000 tons of radioactively contaminated seawater, and they were hoping that they would be able to slow down the rate at which they were pumping more water, because they're still pumping water in to keep the temperature of the reactors low enough so they don't go back into fission again. They slowed that process down just the day before yesterday, and immediately the temperature started going up towards boiling point again, and reached about 80 Celsius before they had to stop and carry on pouring water in. So now they still have continued to have, where do we store all these hundreds of thousands of tons of water that we cannot just put back into the ocean as it is, even though it will dilute in the ocean and stuff, but eventually. Where are we gonna store it? How fast can we try and decontaminate it and take out the radioactively contaminated particles? You can't, there's nothing you can do with radiation. It doesn't go, it is what it is. There's no chemical process that you can go through to make something less radioactive. It just decays as it decays. So you have to take it out of the environment, take it out of the water through various different processes. But to dump it back into the ocean that amount would be obviously very, very bad for the environment, especially in a community that survives on fish and so on and so forth to a large extent. This was another one of the meetings that I went to. This is one of the only over here, a local representative from the Fukushima prefecture, the only one actually who is supporting activists in trying to get Fukushima prefecture, the governor, to do more, and not just the regional government, but the federal government, the national government. Because actually the governor of Fukushima, many, many other prefectures around Japan were offering aid to Fukushima, said, we'll house people, we will take people who you want to evacuate, we'll do what, we'll provide food, we'll give you money, just tell us what you want. And the governor of Fukushima prefecture said, we don't need your help, everything is fine, take back your offers. And because why? Because what he wanted was life to go back to normal, the economy to rekindle, things to people who'd evacuated to come back. He was worried about tax receipts and how much income the government was going to get. Incredibly short-sighted. So there was such a furore and such a scandal about that that he had to retract that. And obviously aid is now being given, and many people from Fukushima are housed all over in cities and towns around Japan. But he is speaking with a pretty famous Japanese actor, Taro Yamamoto, who is a film and TV actor, but he is now basically dedicating his life to trying to do something about the question of radiation shutting down the plants, and has become an anti-nuclear activist. Since doing that, of course, the offers to go and make films have dried up, and so he's not a film actor anymore. He's on TV, he's doing TV stuff, but he doesn't see that as an important thing. He thinks this is what he's doing is far more important. And I said, well, why are you doing this? It seems like you're losing your livelihood. So he said, because I want to live. People's human rights are being violated in Fukushima, and if they can do it to the people here, eventually they will do it to me. And I don't want to see Japan end. But this is not just about Japan. This is the whole world. That was his. And then I was just going from Tokyo to... That was in Kuriyama City, which is in Fukushima Prefecture. And then I was going from Tokyo to Kyoto to meet with some other people, activists there. And I just was at Tokyo Station. I bumped into him again. And here he is. He was taking part in a referendum about nuclear power and trying to get people to sign up to make sure that there is a national referendum and people are engaged with the political process around the question of nuclear power. And so he was up on a soapbox for as long as I was there, signing people up, yes, no, all from all walks of life. And they had started this campaign 3 months ago when I got there, and they were hoping for to get 10 million signatures by March 11th. But when I was there in December, or January now, I guess, they'd already got 2 million signatures, which is, in 3 months, is obviously an enormous groundswell of an enormous achievement for grassroots activists without the backing of the government, against the corporations, against the mass media. So this was really very exciting. And he's pretty hot too, I have to say. Anyway. So this is another well-known environmental activist who, let me just... Yu Tanaka, who's written several books in Japanese and been a long campaigner against nuclear power, but also many different environmental activists. He's been building buildings that will last for 300 years. One of his main campaigns is to build sustainable buildings and to stop the logging that goes on in Japan. And so he's been part of it. He's also set up a community non-profit bank that people can pay into for sustainable development purposes. So all the money goes to building buildings, for example, that are built without any chemicals and designed to last for 300 years. What a concept. It was fantastic to get to meet him. And one of the questions, so this will be an interview that, as soon as I transcribe it, will be coming out fairly soon, probably. One of the things I asked him was, if you could say anything that you wanted to the people of the United States, what would that be? What would you advise them to do? So this is what he told me. He said, the biggest problem in the United States is the defense industry. The defense industry is closing in on the sixth largest emitter of CO2. So what I want the U.S. and the United States people to do is demilitarization. Unless the U.S. demilitarizes and disarms, there is no solution. The defense industry is so massive in the United States that the government has come to rely on it completely. So I would say U.S. environmentalists have to demand that the U.S. disarm, which I thought was a pretty powerful statement and and a lot of it, environmentalists don't look at the military so much often, and it is half of federal taxes go to the U.S. military currently, and it has a budget, the Pentagon, of almost $1 trillion. So imagine what we could do with that $1 trillion, the kind of energy systems that we could come up with. Thank you. Yeah, there's a lot of things that make sense when you talk about them, and then you realize you have to think about why aren't they being done, and then you turn into an activist. Yes, the member of the prefectural government I was looking for before, Shinichiro Ishihara, was the person. This was somebody that I stayed with when I was in Tokyo, Mr. Hideto Okochi. And he is one of the leaders of what's called the Engaged Buddhist Movement in Japan. This is Mr. Okochi here. I was at, this is the last day of the year in Japan, and so there's this big celebration to say goodbye to all the things that didn't go quite right in the last year and kind of welcome in the new year. So lots of food, which is great. All of these are different environmental activists that I was speaking with at something that he had organized. An amazing, incredible person. So I stayed at his at the temple in Tokyo with him. The Engaged Buddhist Movement believes that we don't have to wait for the Pure Land in the next world. We can actually achieve it here. And so he's been fighting for a long time around environmental issues, particularly global warming. He's traveled all over Southeast Asia, and his temple is sustainably built and so on and so forth. So one of the things that he said was, a volunteer, according to Juko In, thinking is not a person who provides his or her cheap labor to fill in cracks left by the administration, or a person looking for his or her own satisfaction. Volunteers look for the true nature of the problems and promote movements oriented towards social reforms. They should take the side of the weaker, of the people, and not the strong side of the system. So he works with Edogawa's Citizens Network for thinking about global warming, and this is part of that network, and it was a whole lot of different environmental NGOs that I met with and had food with. This is in Fukushima again. This is Chieko Shina. She is a DJ for the local radio station, and the earthquake struck, and she immediately thought, well, where's the best place to go to get information? I'll go to the radio station. So she managed to get to the radio station after the earthquake, before the tsunami hit, and spent the next 10 days reporting 24/7 with one other person who made it to the radio station, trying to get information out about what was really going on. She's leaving for Hokkaido in the north because she wants to have a child, and so she's giving up her livelihood in Fukushima city because she's just not sure what the radiation is going to do to her or her child. So she's packing up and leaving along with many, many other people. But she was really keen to let me know. She expressed lots of different things. I interviewed her for a while. She was a really fascinating person. But she was pretty keen to have me know that this was not just some traditional way of protecting women or some patriarchal sense that the women were most involved because they were most worried just about the children or anything like that. It was much more a human rights issue. And so she said to me, it's not a mother and child thing, it's about women. People think because it's the evacuation of women and children, it makes it seem like it's a traditional issue. It's a women's issue. We need to make this clear if we want change. It's fundamentally about the right to life. Another one of the very amazing people that I met while I was there. Now this is back in the United States. And if we haven't learned anything about where to site nuclear power plants, you know where this is? California. San Onofre, yes. It's on the beach. You couldn't get more on the beach than that. You can walk along here. So they just had closed this nuclear plant just a couple of weeks ago because it was leaking radiation, and they weren't sure, they couldn't find out where from. So even normal operation of nuclear plants is obviously dangerous. They haven't been able to restart it because they've got to locate where it's leaking from first. But yes, this this is in this country. Thanks. Some of the other people I met in Fukushima City, again, women, this is an organic farmer who you saw earlier, Sachko, who I met first here. But there are some difficulties now. That the economic situation is very bad, as you can imagine. And so there are some there's some friction developing between the people who are evacuated and on government support, basically, and the people who have not been evacuated but are still losing their jobs because the economy is going down. So some of them didn't want to give me their real name, they just what town they were from, because they felt like they might face reprisals from the people around them. So it's creating a lot of social dislocation because of the desperate economic system situation that has been caused by not just the tsunami, but obviously the resulting nuclear crisis. Thanks. So this is their school where their kids go, and they brought this in to show me because all these numbers, you can't really see them. I have another slide, but these are all different radiation levels. So imagine sending your kid to a school where you've got to take a piece of paper and start reading about the location and variability of the radiation levels. So this is a bit of an expanded version. These are all different figures around the school for that. Thanks very much. The other thing they showed me was this is from the Japanese government. And so they have to fill this in every day or every week for their children to note down where they've been during the day and what they've been eating. This is a radiation dosimeter that they have to give to their child to carry around with them all the time. And then, the next page. If you go back one page. I don't think you can see it, actually. Go forward again. So this is a pretty involved form, right? And you have to keep doing this over and over again until it's full. So very, very scary, obviously, and they posed the question to me, which seems like the most obvious question that you could possibly ask. If it's so safe here, why are they giving us these? Right? Very, very direct and frightening. The other thing that, actually, if you go back to the previous school's picture, and the one before that, yeah, they actually made sure to cover over who it was being sent to because they didn't want to be identified. And then you go into, that's good, you go into an apartment building in Fukushima and you don't see some nice painting of a fish or something like that, but you see something like this. So this is every 7 days, people are compiling radiation level readings from all around, inside and all around the apartment building. So this is in the foyer, and you can see they're circling high levels in Fukushima City, which is 60 kilometers away from Fukushima Daiichi, the nuclear plants. And this changes, obviously, every day, every week. There are different locations where it's high, where it's low. Very, very scary. Sachko, the woman who I mentioned earlier, she was also an organic farmer, but she can't farm anymore. She has food that she can last for a couple of years because she's been busily just building up the things that she preserves and so on. But what she has done with some of her friends is set up an organic shop in Fukushima City, but she can't sell anything organic from Fukushima Prefecture. It all comes from everywhere else in Japan. So she's getting sent stuff by other organic farmers in solidarity with her and the people of Fukushima. But it's not just an organic shop, it's also an organizing center So there are many, many meetings that go on there at the same time. And she, similarly, she can't be a farmer anymore. She's evacuated her children. She's staying there purely to work on the evacuation of all the children. Yes.
It was wrapped in plastic, everything. If you could go back
yep.
one picture. Everything is in plastic. Is that for because of radiation?
No, I don't think so. The levels of recycling actually in Japan are far, far higher than the United States. The level of cleanliness in the whole country was very different for starters, but also the recycling levels are much higher. There's much more thought goes into the packaging and so on. So it's not really related to the radiation. No. Plus, plastic wouldn't do you any, wouldn't help you. I mean, it would stop alpha radiation, but so would your skin. So. I went into a mall in Fukushima City, or I was taken to a mall, and you don't expect to come across this in your average mall. The government is not doing the radiation monitoring, so the people have to do it themselves. So they've set up, they're all volunteers, they're now just working to measure radiation in the food, or in children, or in any adults that come along. So this is the citizens' radioactive measuring station in the mall. They got funding and training through a French NGO, so they know about radiation and how to operate the machines. They got machinery donated from overseas, and they're measuring people every single day. So this is a device for measuring the radiation in food, rice, and seaweed, and all everything else, everything else, tea. That you might want to measure the radiation of that grows in the region or comes from the region. But it also is a place where the children go to have their radiation levels measured. So there's lots of toys there too. Pete? Thanks, sorry. So this is a whole body scanner where you would go to have you or your children sit and measure your radiation. The female DJ that I mentioned had been there. She felt like her radiation levels were elevated, one of the reasons she wanted to move away. But you can, if you're under 20, you can have your radiation levels measured for free.
How does that measure radiation? Is it taking particles off your skin?
No, it's just a more sensitive Geiger counter. That will measure how much ionizing radiation that you are giving off, either externally or internally. So this is actually, it was donated from Belarus, so it looks a little East European, a little primitive, but I'm assured that that it works. So one of the last things that I did in Kuriyama was go and speak to a meeting that was held by a network of mostly women, but it wasn't just women, who are organizing to marches in Tokyo, the occupation in Tokyo, which is about 100 miles away, so they're constantly going backwards and forwards, to demand that the government take more action, as I said, around letting people know what the real situation is with radiation, because the other thing is you just have to constantly live in fear. You don't really know what's going on, right? And to have them evacuate more people, and also to support the people who are voluntarily evacuating, who are currently without any money from the government. So you could keep going, I think. So people were recounting their experiences either with the earthquake or with the tsunami, and just about how their lives were now very different to what they had been before. So it was a very emotional meeting. Obviously, I couldn't understand what people were saying, but in many ways, you really didn't need to understand what to recognize the kind of trauma that people were going through. And this was, the meeting was actually a good place where people could come together and start talking and not just organizing for future demonstrations and protests, but also as a support network for each other. Um, demonstrations that they organized that came out of that meeting in Kuriyama City, whereby this is a protest, another protest outside TEPCO and outside the ministry of the ministry that houses NISA, which is the Japanese equivalent of the NRC, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, that operates in this country, just as corrupt, just as pro-corporate as what goes on over here. We found out only after Fukushima Daiichi that 80% of the nuclear workers in Japan are actually untrained day laborers, purely to reduce costs. So these people who run this system, not only do they skimp and cut corners on health and safety at every opportunity, they even do it with nuclear power plants. So now the people who are cleaning up now are the same very badly treated, poorly paid day laborers, contract workers, who are having to run in and run back out in order to not expose themselves to lethal levels of radiation. They've currently accumulated 480,000 used and radioactively contaminated radiation suits. So individual radiation suits for the workers are now at 480,000, because once you've worn it once, you can't wear it again. You have to get a new one for the next day. So imagine how many man-hours, person-hours, that currently is. And we're only 1 year into the situation, and they haven't got anywhere near the cause to find out what's going on there. There are hundreds of thousands of tons of water. The most heavily contaminated water is still in the buildings, in the basements of those buildings. What are they going to do with that? They haven't got a plan for that yet.
Are the majority of those workers Japanese, or are they immigrants that they're importing from?
Mostly Japanese workers. The economy in Japan, as people probably know, has not been doing well for over a decade. And the level at which people are working is really extreme in order to try and get jobs. Japan, Tokyo in particular, has the highest rate of youth suicide of any developed country because of the situation with trying to get a job and going to college and then not being able to get one. And kind of some of that is cultural, but a lot of it is just a desperation that we just can't fit anywhere. So people are they've increased the pay for these workers to a certain extent. You know, in exchange for going into a nuclear power reactor, we will increase your pay, but it's still very low. But it's enough to get enough people to say, I have to do it. I've got no choice, regardless of what it may do to me, you know, over the long term or whatever. So this is, this is the heart of the Dark Empire here. In terms of the TEPCO building, and this was the video that I showed at the beginning. This was the demonstration that that I was at, that had been planned at the previous meeting, where I spoke. Is that it? Yeah. So you can see there's a whole range of people at the demonstration. They've got obviously lots of demonstrations planned for March 11th, just like we have over here. Yes?
It appears that there are more women who are doing the demonstrating and the protesting, is that true?
Yes.
Why do you think that is?
Like I was saying, I think that there is something about the fact that children are more affected, and so women are at the forefront of that. But it is creating a new women's rights movement in Japan, so it's going to feed into all kinds of other areas of organizing. So it's a really exciting development, not just for the anti-nuclear power movement, but for gender equity and the genesis of all other new associated movements, because we know from the civil rights movement that started with civil rights, but then extended to and created the modern women's rights movement, the gay liberation movement, the modern environmental movement, were all created as people generalized from their experience fighting for civil rights for African Americans and said, well, if we can win this, maybe we can win other things. And why do the corporations have a right to pollute my environment? Why can't I control my own body? Why is it wrong for me to like somebody from the same sex. You know, so people started to generalize, and I think, you know, we have the potential here to do, there's the potential to look at the same kind of effect in Japan, as I met many, many very strong, independent-minded, and passionate, and organized women, female activists, which was very exciting to see. So this is all the same demonstration, but it did bring to mind one of the demonstrations that I was part of, but one of the many demonstrations that I was part of last year, along with Occupy Wall Street, the demonstration outside, I think this is the UN, to get Indian Point shut down, you know, 36 years old, leaking, decrepit, and they wanted to last, relicense it for another 20 years, so we would have a 60-year-old nuclear power plant 25 miles or so from here. Absolute madness. And the recent report from the state government here said that we don't even need to build more electricity generating to take the place of Indian Point. We could close it down and there would be no problem. There are already many times when it is closed down, either for safety reasons, accidents, or for general maintenance, and obviously we never notice. So it's not like we couldn't live without this monster. Not only does it leak on a regular basis, but it kills billions of fish every year. It totally alters the ecosystem of the Hudson River, which could be an absolutely beautiful and amazing river, and in many cases, obviously, it really is already, but it's destroyed the ecosystem of the lower Hudson with putting in vast quantities of overheated water that is too hot to go back into the river, and totally changes the ecosystem, apart from sucking in billions of fish every year into their intake, and killing them off. So a very dangerous plant that I would encourage everybody to get involved in that movement. Let alone earthquakes, it's on two fault lines as well, yeah. So I guess another demonstration. I won't go into this too much. And then, yeah, keep going. But people were really inspired, I should just mention. People were really inspired by the Occupy Wall Street movement. So there were Occupy signs in lots of different places. People were really interested in what I had to say about, I'm in the Environmental Solidarity Working Group of Occupy Wall Street, and involved with that, as well as Shut Down Indian Point Now, as well as a few other things. So that was really exciting. Lots of international solidarity. And we would have like 4-hour long meetings, and then we would go to a demonstration, and then from the demonstration we would go and do something else. And so this was after the meeting, after the demonstration, and then the rally at the occupation site. We then marched to Ginza, which is the really fancy shopping district of Tokyo, to hand out leaflets and do some more campaigning. And everybody had microphones, loudhailers. We went stopped by the police, had a mini protest outside. And we're handing out lots of flyers about the reality of Fukushima and the ongoing organizing against it. So, that's it. So. But I'm very happy to take questions and comments and discussion. So, and probably other people can also answer other people's questions. It's not like, I'm sure there are plenty of people who know lots of things. Do you want to?
Please,
sir.
Yeah, please.
Go ahead.
So you've been there before, is that correct?
No, my first visit to Japan.
Oh, it was your first visit? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so in terms of that fisherman,
my feeling was, if people could live there and continue with their life and fight for what they thought was right, then me being there for a few days was insignificant.
And the woman who was the organic farmer.
Yes. Satchiko Sato.
Yes, I've read stories when this first broke about how people were selling their food in the marketplace, and people were buying food, and the government was trying to say that, yes, the food was good and it was safe. And obviously that was not the case, and this seems to have shifted, correct? Is that correct now?
Well, it's more, it's not so much necessarily that the food is really heavily contaminated or dangerous. It's more that people don't know exactly what the situation is. So there's lots of rumors flying around about what food is contaminated, how heavily it's contaminated, whether you can eat it or not eat it. So it's not even that necessarily, obviously there is some contamination of some food, some particular types of food. But it's not that widespread, at least as far as we know. The main thing is that there's just not enough testing going on for people to safely know what the real situation is. And so it's more a question of people are living in a constant state of fear and unknowing about what really is safe or not. And so that's one of the main thrusts of the campaign is to, you know.
And that particular organic farmer, that woman, what was her take on this? And this is a woman who was used to farming her land and now she's displaced. What was she doing now?
Her take was she is going to fight till the end of her life to get reparations and justice from the government, not just for her, for everybody else.
Okay, so there's a bunch of hands on stack. I haven't gotten everyone, so if you raise your hand, just make sure to raise it again. I have, and some of you I know, some of you I don't, and I apologize if in the confusion I forget your name. But I have Olive here first, followed by the gentleman in the striped shirt. So Olive?
I just wondered, do you have any feeling about the political situation in Japan? Are they likely, because of this, to vote in any kind of different government?
Well, the problem is a little bit, well, very like here. If you want to vote in somebody who's anti-nuclear, you can't at the moment. In the same way that you can't here either. You can't vote for a Democrat or a Republican if you are anti-nuclear. And the same situation with the two main parties in Japan is also true. They got rid of Khan because of the disaster that his administration did for the nuclear crisis. But now they have Inoda, who's even more pro-nuclear than Khan was. So in terms of what's happening politically, it's the reason that many of the nuclear reactors are shut down is because of the pressure of local people on regional governments. So the national government wants to restart all of the, it's in bed with the corporations, they want to restart all the reactors. But the regional governments are facing too much pressure from the people of those regions to allow them to restart. So they're not allowing it. So it's more about the grassroots pressure than being able to elect a different government. And probably people could fill you in, other people better than me, on the political situation in Japan with like official politics. I admit to not knowing very much about that.
Gentleman in the striped shirt, followed by the woman in the scarf.
Yes, you mentioned the growing women's movement in Japan. With the fact that the Commission on the Status of Women will be meeting at the UN from the 27th of February to March 11th, did you meet anyone in Japan that was working on having a presence here in New York during this?
Yeah, there are people. Go ahead.
You know, the woman, the farmer, Sachiko, mm-hmm. we where is Emily from Peaceboat?
She's here.
She's here. We have a letter from her and a statement that we're trying to get into the United Nations to the Commission on the Status of Women.
Right, I'm familiar with that. I'm wondering if you knew.
She was in the film then.
We are hoping to bring some more people over from Japan for March, some of whom will be nuclear experts, some of them will be eyewitnesses to who live in Fukushima, if we can afford to bring them over, because the various organizations are all grassroots and we're broke. But if we can also bring up, we particularly are obviously interested in bringing over some of the female leadership and taking them to the UN or having them go to the UN. So if we can do that, we certainly will. So We're working on that right now.
And the woman in the squad?
Yes, this is just a piece of information to fill in something that you said. When you talked about the fact that the Japanese government has been crushed or manipulated by the U.S. government.
Yeah.
When the U.S. government was so hated for having dropped the bomb, they wondered here how they could ever win back Japanese, because they wanted to have Japan as a place for bases for the U.S. Ostensibly, they were going to protect the Japanese, but really, we have over 100 bases in Japan and Okinawa. So last year, through Freedom of Information, documents came out that showed the strategy devised by John Foster Dulles and Eisenhower, how to sell nuclear energy as a wonderful thing for the Japanese. Mm-hmm. And it was a main campaign. Mm-hmm. Of course, they won. We believed in it here. The Japanese thought, oh yeah, we'll have energy, we don't have to worry about oil. But it was a very cleverly crafted policy in 1954.
Well,
the documents are out.
And it's not just about what the US wanted. It's also the case that Japan doesn't have much in the way of natural resources in terms of oil and coal. And so how are you going to generate electricity? So that is a real question. Though, there was a recent report released by Greenpeace and Sustainability Center in Tokyo that their report showed that Japan by 2020 could generate 43% of its energy from renewable sources. And as I mentioned, the environmentalist that I spoke with said, look, Japan is surrounded by oceans. We have regular and constant wind. It's a country full of mountains. We are a geologically active island. The idea that we could provide for our energy needs from wind, wave, tidal, geothermal is ludicrous. So the point is that we just haven't tried it, because all the money has been sucked up by the nuclear power plants, because it's enormously expensive to build nuclear power plants and operate them.
Great, so I have Evan and Emily in the back.
Hi, I'm Evan from Shutdown Indian Point Now. I just want to urge everyone in the room to learn the lessons of this tragedy from last year in Japan. We started our organization just after the Fukushima disaster at the end of March last year, but there have been activists that have been working to shut down Indian Point for decades. Right now, we're starting to see some fruits of our labor. We feel that the only way to shut down the plant is by building massive public pressure on our government. And what we've seen in Japan and here in the United States is complicity of the government with the nuclear power corporations. And the only way to fight that is by massive public pressure. So I want to urge everyone to sign our sign-in sheets and really step up and become activists after tonight. We're having the anniversary of Fukushima in March. We will be announcing some meetings that you can come to in March, but you need to get those meetings by being on our email list. So please sign up tonight. Thanks.
Great. So, Emily?
First of all, Chris, I just want to thank you so much for your presentation. My name is Emily McGlone. I'm from the United States, but just came back from spending 10 years in Japan working for the NGO Peace Book. And Chris also had a chance to visit our office, which would be a pleasure. I think this is a really accurate report of what's actually happening in Japan still today. And right after Chris left, we had a conference organized in Yokohama, Japan, where we had 11,500 people attend the conference. And that was civil society organized. We had guest speakers from 40 different countries around the world. We hope Chris could stay as well. But
yeah,
we really want to make sure that Indian Point is on the agenda for closing nuclear power plants around the world. And I just moved to New York after living in Japan, but we're kind of making our office now a hub for getting information about different nuclear power stations. And I'd like to welcome all of you to, you know, join us or give us information, and let's share and try to work together to make this happen, because after Japan, we don't want to have
right.
something happen anymore.
Right.
Thank
you. Do you have a website?
Sure, it's peacebook.org. Just one word, peacebook.org. And I'll be around afterwards if you'd like to exchange.
Great, Chris?
Yeah. From having grown up in Florida, I know that Georgia has been engaged in a legal battle for water rights with its neighbors because the Atlanta metropolitan region has already outgrown its water table. So I'm wondering about the effects on the water supply that adding two new nuclear plants would have. And I'm sure, you know, California has been dealing with the same problem in other, you know, Western areas.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. On the one hand, they've reinvented nuclear power as the answer to climate change. On the other hand, because of climate change, it makes nuclear power even less practical than it was prior to that, because the extended droughts and low water tables that many areas are suffering from as a result of the beginning effects of climate change is making nuclear power plants inoperable. In France, for example, they've had to cut down use of nuclear power plants and take them offline because during the summer months, at some points, either the river water is too low or the temperature of the river water is too high to use it as a coolant. It won't cool the nuclear power plants enough. So one of the things about nuclear power plants is they need an enormous, as we know, if the water isn't flowing, then that's you're heading towards meltdown straight away. So they need an enormous and constant supply of water. That's why they're all on the coasts. It's why they're all on rivers, like Indian Point, for example. And so this is a huge issue. And actually, if you go to the USGS, United States Geological Service, they have a report whereby what is the biggest single user of fresh water supplies in the US? It's thermal power plants. So coal, power plants, nuclear power plants, gas-fired power plants, because you need some method of heat exchange and cooling to keep them running. So the single biggest user, and just one more reason, if you don't need enough already, to get rid of thermal power plants like coal, natural gas, and nuclear plants, is they just devastate the local water supply. And with climate change, that's going to become an even bigger problem. So in Georgia, yes, not only is it a problem for the water, before they even start, you know, polluting it with heat and with radiation, it's a question of how are they going to share that water out, and what's going to happen in the summer months when they haven't got enough. And California is already facing water shortages because the Rockies are melting faster than the ice pack on the Rockies, where they get their water from, is melting faster than it used to. So all of these things are interconnected. So really we need to move away from power plants that use such vast quantities of water.
So I have the woman in the gray sweater in the back.
One other thing about Georgia, actually, they haven't even built the plants yet, and the taxpayers of Georgia are already paying for them. It's so uneconomic, nuclear power plants, that they have to force the taxpayers, they have to put a special law in place in Georgia to allow the power plants to charge extra for their electricity to subsidize the plants before they're built. So they're already paying for electricity that's not even being provided.
And I just want to say, if you feel like I missed you, feel free to raise your hand. And if you have something to add while people are talking, just feel free to raise your hand until I spot you.
I think we're probably going to go on till 9:30 or something. Is that right, Chris? So just so people know, it's like 9 o'clock now. We'll wrap up in about less than 30 minutes or so. So, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a nice lecture and information.
Thank you for coming.
I have a question about Japanese media. Every day I check Japanese news, newspaper on the internet, and I have never seen those demonstrations and protection. And I wonder if it is because of the internet, or do you see or do you read any information about demonstration on Japanese newspapers and TV?
Some of the people might be able to answer Japanese media better than me in the room, but it's not awful lot different to here, right? The best way to find out about the political situation in the United States is to read somebody, some other country's media. The same could be said of Japan. The Japan Times, in English, I don't read Japanese, but the Japan Times has had carried quite a few reports on the situation, but there's not been much reporting. The mainstream media in Japan is just as controlled by the corporations as it is here. There's no real difference. So, of course, they're not reporting anything more than they have to. The odd thing, just like the odd thing, comes out in the New York Times, which is useful or interesting, not much. And so, you know, in this country, when there was a frenzy of reporting about a few hundred people going to Tea Party demonstrations, while we were all having tens of thousands of our demonstrations against the war, whatever it was, whatever issue it was not getting reported. It's very similar. They had a demonstration in Japan of 60,000 in Tokyo that was barely reported by the media, and that's an enormous number for Japan. And the other thing that I found out about Japan was you know, people talk about people following rules or not demonstrating or being passive or docile or whatever. Actually, there's a law in Japan that the police have the right to arrest you and hold you without charge for up to 23 days at a protest. So that will put a dampener on your illegal protest activities, because if you're held in jail without charge for 23 days, you can say goodbye to your job, right? So it's an enormously risky thing to go out and have a full-on protest.
Okay, Donna?
One of the movements is one of the demands is, by some people at least in Japan, is to separate the generating companies from the transmission companies, which is what happens here, right? Con Ed distributes the power, but Entergy, for example, runs Indian Point, and they produce the power. So there's a separation between the people who generate the power and the people who transmit it. Not in Japan, they're the same corporation. So they basically control and run and do whatever they want, right? If you don't like it, we're not going to give you electricity. We can jack up the rates to whatever we want, there's no ability to control them. So the people there are campaigning and think that if they can separate those two, then there will be some incentive for change. I personally am not so convinced by that argument, because I live here and it's a disaster.
Right.
So I would be more in favor of what we really need to do is renationalize the power supply. Because there's a very big difference between having something provided as a service to the people versus a commodity that we have to buy. So once it becomes for profit, then Entergy, these other corporations, Con Ed, they have no interest in cutting consumption. In fact, their interest is diametrically opposed to that. They want to increase consumption. Once you have a corporation, a for-profit corporation, running your electrical grid, it is a disaster. Because not only do they want to increase consumption and build more nuclear power plants or whatever it is, they also have no interest in doing maintenance. They want to do the least amount of maintenance they could possibly get away with. And so, of course, in any given year, one-third of American households suffer a blackout. One-third at some point in the year. And that's because nobody does but the barest amount of maintenance on the national grid. I mean, we know from, 2003 in New York? Yeah. A tree falls in Iowa. And
Ohio.
Ohio, sorry.
One of those
died. Yeah, they all sound the same. Yes, somewhere in the middle. I shouldn't say things like that. But I'm not from here. Yes, a tree falls, that's what caused it, right? On a substation power line, and it sends a surge through the rest of the power supply transmission grid, and it causes a blackout over the whole of the Northeast. And that is how old and antiquated this system is, that they're not, because the real problem is, not so much that we don't have enough power generated around the country, but we can't transmit it, because nobody's building a new smart grid so that we can, like in Germany, for example, they can now, they have a smart grid that they've already built some of it, so that when the wind isn't blowing in one area of Germany, but the sun isn't shining in one area, it's cloudy somewhere else, but windy somewhere else, they just pass the electricity back and forth, so that you can exchange where you've got lots of electricity to somewhere where you don't. So that kind of integrated thinking is obviously seriously lacking from here.
So the gentleman with the beard.
I've heard it said that the reporters are reluctant to go anywhere near Fukushima Daiichi because of danger to themselves. And I wanted to know if that is true, and in general, not just about the political situation or the demonstrations, but how much reportage was there of the actual situation. You described the dereliction of duty of the government. What about the press?
I mean, the mainstream press, you know, I don't think they're particularly interested, or the people who run the mainstream press are pretty uninterested in doing it. I think on the ground, like I said, the photographer who'd been there and was publicizing photos, because you can't get within 20 kilometers, I mean, there's military all the way around. Actually, one journalist I did speak to from Fukushima City, she was going to smuggle me in the trunk of her car, not her car, somebody else's car. That didn't end up happening. But there's definitely people who are trying to report on the situation, but not from the mainstream press, in the same way that we have to have an alternative press here, it's the same thing.
So the woman in pink, I'm sorry I skipped you.
That's okay. Fritha, I'm glad that Occupy sign is still up because it reminds, you know, it's the connection between Indian Point. Spread the word that Indian Point Energy claims they're providing 30% of our energy here in the city, and it's not true. And we have answers, so I hope you come. And if you have trouble reading this, you can reach us at renewny@gmail.com.
And in fact, Ken Gale, who runs the Ecologic Show on WBAI, 8 o'clock on Tuesday evenings, highly recommend the show. I think I'm going to be on it in March sometime.
March 6th.
March 6th, yeah.
8 p.m.
8 p.m. So,
99.5 FM.
99.5 FM, highly recommend, as an alternative radio station that actually does produce some real news about the world. Certainly, I've argued in my book and lots of other places that the whole problem with whether we can have an alternative or sustainable society that doesn't pollute and damage the Earth as we so obviously manifested in many different ways currently and so sadly, is not a technical problem at all. Right? We know all of the answers. We have the technology. I'm not saying we couldn't improve it with more research, but there is only one direction that fossil fuels and nuclear power, in terms of cost, are going to go, and that's up. There is only one direction that solar power, wind power, etc., the costs for that are going to go. That's down. So, and wind power is already cost competitive with fossil fuels, particularly if you took out the horrendous amount of subsidies that fossil fuels get. So, I argue that it's got nothing to do with a technological issue. It is purely political and social. Who has the power and who doesn't? And how do we change that equation?
Do folks want to make announcements at the end, or would you like to just mention them in what you're saying?
We've been doing
this. Yeah, okay, so I guess, okay. So you serve.
Okay, and actually, it's an announcement that I wanted to make. But first, Chris, thank you for witnessing the struggle of the Japanese people around this issue. I wanted to share with you something about the No More Fukushimas Peace Walk, which is happening. It's starting on March 2nd, and it's going until March 21st. This is a Japanese Buddhist. You want me to use this?
Yeah, sure.
It's
fine. No, it's fine.
It's right here. So the No More Fukushimas Peace Walk is a 19-day peace walk, which is starting on March 2nd at the Oyster Creek Nuclear Facility on the Jersey Shore. It's organized by a Japanese Buddhist organization here in the States, but it's a group of walkers of all faiths. They're going to walk from Oyster Creek to Indian Point, through New York City to Indian Point, and up to Vermont Yankee. just to read briefly from their flyer, their walk is a prayer for the suffering of the Japanese people as a result of their government's reckless nuclear policies, and a plea for the people of New Jersey, New York, and New England to recognize the grave dangers the nuclear energy poses to our lives, our property, and all life on our Mother Earth. They will be vigiling at each of the three power plants, and the one of the real goals of this is to kind of bring together the three separate struggles that are happening at each of the power plants to unite those. So I want to encourage all of you to walk with us, especially on March 8th. We will be walking from Zuccotti Park, gathering there at 9 in the morning and walking to the George Washington Bridge. If you want to come up to Indian Point, we'll be vigiling at the gates of Indian Point on March 11th. So there's a number, many, many opportunities to engage all along the way. My name is Christian Collins. I have flyers. There's some on the table back there.
Aren't you going up to the UN that day before the George Washington?
That's correct. We're going from Zuccotti at 9 o'clock to the UN, and then to the George Washington Bridge. Please come walk with us. Bring signs. This is an amazing opportunity to be out in the streets to make this issue really visible in the public eye, and lots of flyers. Just talk to me afterwards.
What's the name of your organization?
Nippon Zan Myo Hoji is the name. The Grafton Peace Pagoda is who's initiating it. All of that is on this flyer, which I'd be happy to pass around to. And my friend Mickey here has copies of the petition that Chris mentioned, where they're trying to get 10 million signatures.
Yeah.
So,
great.
10 million and 50.
Yeah.
I can't wait any longer. We're all here, and I so appreciate everybody being here. If you didn't sign in, please sign in, because we want to get back to everybody. And if you can't do that, you can email us at shutdownindianpointnow@gmail.com and get on our email list and get notices of all these upcoming events. And then I want to ask your special support for this incredible event that we hope is going to happen. We got an email from Occupy Moscow to Occupy Wall Street, and it came to me, and I went down to, they want to do a joint statement between Occupy Moscow and Occupy Wall Street on nuclear abolition and disarmament. And they sent us a draft statement, and we drafted and included nuclear power as part of nuclear abolition, because as Chris explained at the beginning of his talk, every one of these nuclear reactors is a bomb factory, and we're not going to get rid of the bomb if we don't shut down nuclear power. So we have copies of the joint declaration. It's now at the point where our working group approved it, and on February 28th, on Tuesday night, at 60 Wall Street, the General Assembly will hear it, and we would love everybody to come down and vote for it so that we can go back to Moscow and really move this across America and Russia and start to move for nuclear abolition. Thank you.
There's people in the General Assembly have already rejected it, so we do need that
support.
Well,
they didn't reject it. They just, it was tabled.
Okay, I see your hand. So we're running out of time. I'd ask people to please keep your comments to about 2 minutes so everyone will get a chance. We have a long list. I just want to remind people that we have copies of Chris's book, Ecology and Socialism, Solutions to the Capitalist Ecological Crisis. And he is so kindly offered to sign copies after this meeting. So if you want to get your personalized copy and have a brief conversation with Chris, that's going to happen after this.
And if people are interested, I just started a course just this week, the Breck Forum, on capitalism and the ecological crisis, a Marxist analysis. So if people are interested in that, the next course is for 6 weeks, Thursdays, 5:30 to 7:30, if you're interested. We're going to be reading the book together and then discussing contemporary articles and a much wider array of issues than just focusing on nuclear power.
So the woman in the green book.
So I wanted to ask about the scientific situation at Fukushima. We all realized and learned that Chemco was lying about what was happening in the beginning, and things have leaked out slowly. But I know there's a lot that's not known because it's so hard to get in there, and so dangerous. So So what I wanted to know is, do you know things that you would like to tell us that we just don't know? And also, you know, about what's really happening, what's known right now about the ongoing accident? And the other thing is there some website or some place that you can go on the internet to kind of keep updated about what is known, you know, what people are discovering? Because it's been hard to get information.
Yeah, the
and,
yeah.
And just to add to that, also the information about what's happening with radiation in the oceans or perhaps coming across this continent or, you know, any of those kinds of questions, is there a place to find out more about that?
Probably one of the best places to go is the Nuclear Information Resource Service, which is based in D.C., a nonprofit that wants to close down nuclear plants and is run mostly by scientists. So that is nirs.org. That would be a good place to get information about both the situation in Japan and over here. The, Gunderson runs a website called Fair Winds, which is great, has lots of videos. He's been on various different TV shows and stuff. Fair Winds is spelled with an E at the end, Winds. But what's his first name?
Arnie
Gunderson, who was running basically a commissioner for the Nuclear Regulatory Commission in the United States, but got so disillusioned by the way in which the NRC did not take nuclear safety seriously. He's a nuclear engineer. He turned away from nuclear power and said this is a bad idea, particularly under this system where things are not really regulated properly. And now he runs a non-profit organization that is dedicated to exposing the risks of nuclear power. So that's another great science-based resource to go to about the risks here and overseas. But in terms of what's going on? Well, I mean, I think the main danger is, you know, the Japanese Prime Minister said the situation is over, which is the last thing that the people in Fukushima wanted to hear. It's so obviously not true, but it also means it's harder to get help from outside if your Prime Minister is saying, don't worry about anything. So, but as I said, a couple of days ago, the temperatures started going up when they slowed down the cooling. And then they have to reinstitute the cooling. They have to throw a load of boron in, which will absorb the neutrons to stop fission reoccurring. So at any point, I mean, who knows, aftershocks from earthquakes can strike not just days or weeks or months later, but years later too. So there could easily be more aftershocks, which can be almost as severe as the original thing. And if you've already got a compromised and damaged nuclear reactor, it's now full of water, right? So it's in a weakened state, and it's got extra hundreds of thousands of tons of water in it. Then, and there's another earthquake, then anything could happen, right? So this the situation is really far from under control, and the Japanese government is saying, I mean, quite openly, they say this is going to be a decades-long process. I mean, it took them 15 years to sort out the mess from Three Mile Island. Three Mile Island was only one nuclear reactor and was only partially melted down to about 30%, and there was no explosion. This is three nuclear reactors, plus a damaged spent fuel pool in an area that has been devastated, right? So, and much more structurally damaged. So how long and how many billions of dollars is it going to take them just to sort out and find out what's going on there, let alone, I mean, in Chernobyl, the giant sarcophagus that they built over the top is 25 years ago, is now collapsing. And because how long do you have to build structures to last?
300,000 years.
A long time. So that's now collapsing. So the Ukrainian government has just been trying to raise $1 billion to start the process to build another one. They hope they finish the second one before the first one collapses, because if it collapses in on the reactor, it will again spread radiation around. So, you know, I mean, the length of time that you have to be thinking about in terms of what goes on with nuclear power, let alone just the question of waste. I mean, there is far more waste, radioactive waste, stored at Indian Point than there was existed at Fukushima Daiichi. And we know now waste is not safe either, right? You have to keep that for, I mean, the US government is officially committed to a policy that will sequester and keep safe radioactive waste for 1 million years. That's their official policy.
Who got that contract?
They got prepaid too.
That's good.
That's a good question. Yes, plutonium, the most toxic element known to humanity, right? 1 microgram of which, if you ingested it, would kill you within minutes, probably. That stays radioactive as a half-life for 24,000 years. So that's 250,000 years right there. Then you have to keep it contained. How could you build a structure to last 250,000 years? Human civilization has been only around 10,000 years. Homo sapiens as a species have only been around 200,000 years. You're talking about trying to keep something safe and building something that would last for longer than Homo sapiens have been around. Now, if that's not an insane way to generate electricity and boil water, I don't know what is. As Einstein said, it's one hell of a way to boil water, referring to nuclear power. So this is the legacy that we're bequeathing, not just our children, but 60 generations of children. Yet one more reason to abandon this, and before we generate any more. I mean, the problem is we've already got 80,000 tons of the stuff, high-level radioactive waste in the United States. What are we going to do with that without generating more? Right, 2,000 more tons get generated every year. That's 2,000 SUVs worth of high-level radioactive waste. And there is no, what's the plan for dealing with that? There is no plan at the moment in the United States because they abandoned the upper mountain. So, as a, not that that was a good plan either, but there currently literally is no plan.
So we have a very long list. I don't think we're gonna be able to get to everyone on it. So my apologies. Maybe if you have questions, you can speak to Chris after the meeting. So I'm just gonna call on a few more people. Minori?
Okay, great. So we're organizing an action. I'm Minori, I'm originally from Japan. So March 11th, 2012, Sunday, 1 o'clock Union Square, we have flyers there. We have organizers here, you go, they're there too. We wanna show solidarity with the growing anti-nuke movement in Japan, especially being led by women. And second, we want to raise our concern, voice our concern and anger and anxiety. And most importantly, I think that we here in New York, we want to inform people in the United States in New York, that New York, people in New York who might think that Indian Point is in India, that we have to tell them, right, but seriously, we have to tell them that it's a serious matter, that Fukushima is everywhere. It can happen here, it can happen anywhere. So come out March 11th, ask me any questions. We have flyers here, there, and we have website, Facebook page, Twitter, everything. Come out and join the movement.
And she'll be on my show with Chris on
yes.
the 6th.
What's your webpage?
Webpage is... What's our webpage? Oh, we actually have a flyer here, so if you want to take it.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Cool. So, Heidi?
Oh, it's okay.
Joanna?
Oh,
wow, what is this really blonde group? Woman in the red jacket?
Talking about relates to everything that was said here. What I did is I made a treaty and I submitted this to the United Nations. It's called International Peace Everyday Treaty for Global Truce and Ceasefire. And I'm calling for all nations to go into the United Nations and to take a vote to end all war, period. No exceptions. And there's I think it's a very good idea. I sent it to the Secretary General of the United Nations. I sent it to the President. I'm sending it to every Prime Minister, every Sheikh, everybody. and I'm sending, I sent it already to the Security Council to have, or to see if we can get a global truce. And that will help us, because you're talking about end nuclear power. I have that in here, ending nuclear power, going green. So my treaty, I'll just read it to you. What
no, that's okay. We're no, right. Thank you very much.
Anyway, my website is goingforaglobaltruce.com.
Thank you.
Okay, Edie?
Yeah, I have heard that there's also a lot of cover-up going on in this country about the effects of the radiation from Fukushima on our own food supply, either in terms of food imported from Japan or in terms of fallout that was on, you know, agriculture in the West Coast. Is there anything you could say to that?
Well, there have been some reports that they turned off the radiation monitors on the West Coast.
So then it's all fine, but we can't see it.
Immediately after the accident, particularly after the explosions. So we also know that the leaks that the British and French governments within 24 hours were colluding with the British and French nuclear corporations to basically send back and forth emails saying, how can we spin this to make sure that nuclear power still sounds okay? And the governments were taking their cue from the nuclear corporations. So you can bet your bottom dollar that if the French and British governments were up to that, the American government was doing the same thing.
Can I get respond or add to that? Within a few weeks after Fukushima, the U.S. government changed the level, that the EPA changed the level of safe radiation for U.S. citizens. Okay, they, I think they multiplied it by 10, rather than 20, but by 10.
So, Chris, do you have anything to wrap up?
I guess, well, maybe I'll wrap up with one quote from one of my favorite authors. I was just rereading H.G. Wells, and he has this short book, The World Set Free, A Story of Mankind, which starts off with the evolution of humans and goes through various different civilizational stages. But everything, the whole history of humanity was really, really slow, up until the point at which we discovered the atom and the power of the atom in terms of nuclear power. And then things really could take off. And he wrote this in 1914 on the cusp of the First World War, before, only about 4 years after the discovery of the nucleus, let alone nuclear power. But the whole book is about both the glories and the problems of, well, there's an atomic war that he documents. I'm going to read a short quote because I think it gets to, on the one hand, the kind of, this book is actually also cited by a number of the scientists, particularly Leo Szilard, who was one of the main people behind the Manhattan Project, developing the atomic bomb, as an important inspiration and for them in terms of what they thought about nuclear power and why they should do it, because there's a quote in here about if I didn't do it, somebody else would have, in terms of developing the nuclear bomb. And that very similar quote gets used by the nuclear scientists 60 years later after they've developed the nuclear bomb. So it's kind of, so I'll just read the quote, and I think it illustrates a couple of things, apart from how great a writer H.G. Wells is. This spectacle of feverish enterprise was productivity, this crowding flight of happy and fortunate rich people. Every great city was as if a crawling anthill had suddenly taken wing, was the bright side of the opening phase of the new epoch in human history, i.e. that opened up by the promise of nuclear power. Beneath that brightness was a gathering darkness, a deepening dismay. There was a vast development of production, there was also a huge destruction of values. These glaring factories working night and day, these glittering new vehicles swinging noiselessly along the roads, these flights of dragonflies that swooped and soared and circled in the air, were indeed no more than the brightnesses of lamps and fires that gleam out when the world sinks towards twilight and the night. But between these highlights, accumulated disaster, social catastrophe. And I think that that is a metaphor not just for the development of nuclear power, but for the rampant exploitation of humanity and the earth represented by capitalism. And I'm very excited that there is a new movement that has been born around the world, inspired by the amazing events in the Middle East, Egypt, and Tunisia, and then brought back to the United States in Madison, Wisconsin, and of course, Occupy Wall Street, that says that they got bailed out and we got sold out. There is the 1% who own and control everything, and then there's us, the 99%, who work for them. And I think that that is the system that is connected to the fossil fuel corporations and the nuclear corporations that we need to get rid of if we're not going to sink down into the darkness and twilight of a desperately decreased level of choices and opportunities for our world and the things that we love about it. So if you're not already an activist, if you're not part of an organization, you should absolutely get involved.